Well, thank you so much. I'm just really happy to see so many people here today. I guess you need some news, don't you? Thank you, Steve. That's it. No more jokes about that. Next. Welcome. Thank you all for being here. Before I begin my sixth State of the City address, I'd like to thank the Santa Barbara Region Chamber of Commerce, especially Executive Director Steve Cushman, and the staff for hosting this event. I'd also like to introduce the members of your City Council. Councilmember Doss Williams, serving as Mayor Pro Tem this year. Councilmember Roger Horton, who serves as Chair of our Finance Committee. Councilmember Brian Barnwell serves as Chair of our Sustainability Committee. Councilmember Helene Schneider was co-chair of the city-county planning process to end chronic homelessness, and it's already starting to work, and we love it. Councilmember Grandhouse is the newest member of our City Council. And Councilmember Ia Falcone serves as the Chair of the Ordinance Committee. She couldn't be here today. She's attending a League of California Cities meeting. Our City Administrator, Jim Armstrong, is also here on the dais. You'll be hearing from him later in the program. And joining us, too, here somewhere is our City Attorney, Steve Wiley. I want to also introduce another group of hardworking individuals. These are the City's department heads. This is a very talented group of executives with many, many years of experience in local government. I'd like each of them to stand and just remain standing, and then we'll clap at the end. We'll give you a round of applause. Assistant City Administrator Joan Kent, Chief of Police Cam Sanchez, Finance Director Robert Pearson, Waterfront Director John Bradley, Parks and Recreation Director Nancy Rapp, Fire Chief Ron Prince, Airport Director Karen Ramsdale, Public Works Director Tony Nisich, Community Development Director Paul Casey, mostly over in this corner. And our newest department head is Library Director Irene Macias, who's responsible for oversight of our public libraries, and she served on the City Library Services Manager for 9 years. And Administrative Services Director Marcelo Lopez, who's responsible for Human Resources, Information Systems, and the City Clerk's Office. Marcelo has been with the City for more than 10 years. Let's give them a round of applause, please. As mayor of this beautiful city, I'm pleased to welcome you to the 2007 State of the City Address. This morning, I'm proud to share our achievements of the past 12 months, as well as our future goals. Despite many challenges, our accomplishments prove that the city truly leads by example. The city is on the cutting edge of four major policy areas: public safety, neighborhood improvement, long-range planning, and sustainability. Public safety is an area that has recently taken our attention with the unfortunate violent incident a few weeks ago in the downtown area. We were saddened by this tragic event that took the life of a young boy. We offer our condolences to the families involved. The police department has made arrests in the case and are staying alert to retaliation activities. City leaders are continuing to discuss how we can work together to prevent gang-related violence and keep our children out of gangs. The police department has been working with neighborhoods and schools to stop gang activity and help our youth solve problems without resorting to violence. The overall crime rate for the city remains low relative to past years. Major crimes in 2006 were down 14% from the prior year, and they've fallen 31% in the past 10 years. The police department's PAL program continues to expand, bringing police officers and our children together for programs for troubled and disadvantaged youth. Last year, PAL served over 1,000 children in a variety of educational and recreational programs. While this will be a top priority for the police department in the year ahead, we as a community will also need to come together to help our community youth. This is a big year for the fire department. We all know how devastating natural disasters can be. Our region has seen wildfires, floods, and earthquakes. This is why we're taking the lead in emergency preparedness. The city has hired a full-time emergency services manager, Yolanda McGlinchey. Yolanda has over 15 years' experience in emergency services and public safety. We're ready to take the city's disaster preparedness to the next level.
The Office of Emergency Services within the city will be working on disaster preparedness drills and also the disaster preparedness plans. We're also going to be working aggressively on public education and community outreach. With all of the major disasters that have happened within the last several years, the city has taken a proactive stance in creating this division. The city is the only city within the county that has a full-time emergency management position that's going to look at disaster planning and exercising and looking at creating a more disaster-resistant community by beginning to prepare the community itself and the public in disaster preparedness and how they can take care of themselves for 72 hours to a week. Currently, the division is working with other agencies within the county to do Riviera evacuation drill in April. The outcome is to show where the choke points are going to be within the Riviera area when we have a major fire up there, how the residents, it's more of a public education for the residents so they can begin to look at their evacuation routes and how are they going to evacuate. Do they have pets? What if it's during the day or on the weekend, how they're going to evacuate. It's a good drill for both the agencies and the residents within the area to see exactly how coming off that mountain really works. The drill encompasses the Upper Riviera and the Robles area of the Riviera, over 900 homes that we're going to be evacuating. We're working with CHP, Caltrans, Sheriff's Department. We're going to be using the reverse 911 to notify residents. We're going to have traffic control points so we can count how many residents come out of the area as we send apparatus in.
That evacuation drill is going to be on April 28th on a Saturday. So if you live in the Riviera, we hope you'll participate. Actually, preparing yourself at home is your best plan to ensure your family's safety. It's recommended you have food and supplies to care for yourself at home, and we used to say a couple days, but now we're saying for up to a week. We have two emergency preparedness kits. We're going to raffle them off right now. Councilmember Falcone will draw the first name.
I'm not in beautiful Santa Barbara or on any other lovely beach. I'm in beautiful downtown Ontario, California on city business. But I am going to be able to pick the first raffle ticket. So here we go. And the number is 462029. 462029. Have fun, everybody.
If you just raise your hand, there you go. Somebody will get the kit to you. Or maybe we'll do it afterwards. We might be doing it afterwards. No, she just got it. Good. Councilmember Williams will draw the next ticket. Hang on to your tickets because there's more things coming. We have to keep you entertained here. Councilmember Williams will draw the next one. You want to read it off? Just pick a ticket.
I like the drama, Marty.
I know.
My colleague, Mr. Barnwell, asked me, well, did we get a ticket? And then he realized, well, probably not. We're supposed to give it to one of you. I said, well, we'll get emergency services kits. Don't worry. The winning number is 462076.
2076.
2076.
Ed Lundvik. I think architects need to be prepared, don't you? Somebody will bring you the ticket, the disaster preparedness kit. Hang on to your tickets. In July, Council authorized the implementation of a new benefit assessment district within the high fire hazard areas. Approved by a majority vote of property owners in these areas, the Wildland Fire Suppression District will provide funding for additional services to reduce damage from wildland fires. 5 years ago, the city began Neighborhood Improvement Task Force. We focused on making neighborhoods safer, improving service levels for all neighborhoods, and creating partnerships with other agencies and community groups. We've seen many successes in this program, including a new partnership with Union Pacific Railroad.
The program focuses on improving neighborhood infrastructure and services, particularly in neighborhoods with long-term unresolved problems. We're very proud of the work that we have done. Here are a few examples. the repair and installation of streets, sidewalks, landscaping, curbs, and gutters in the Punta Gorda neighborhood. With infrastructure improvements, the neighborhood is safer and more attractive. We started an aggressive program to retrieve abandoned shopping carts. Contract crews routinely drive through neighborhoods, picking up the carts left behind. And we established a shopping cart hotline. TV Hill has been a problem for decades. Trespassing, illegal encampments, and the accompanying fire hazard conditions that have sparked wildland fires in the area. With a fire marshal in the lead, the city moved in with an aggressive enforcement program, enforced trespassing laws to rid the area of illegal encampments and lay the groundwork. The new owner cleaned the area, removed stoves, flammable and toxic materials, makeshift campsites, furniture, power generators, drug paraphernalia, tons and tons of debris. Aliso Street had been the site of an RV fire caused by substandard living conditions, illegal camping, drug use, and excessive garbage. A 12-member crew from Public Works and Parks and Recreation, with the support of the police department, Caltrans, and CHP, teamed up to fill many roll bins and remove tons of debris from the site. Last but not least, we're very proud to announce that we have entered into a financial agreement with Union Pacific Railroad to take on the railroad corridor. Together, we will tackle the problem of trespassing and illegal encampments, remove graffiti, trash, and make the corridor better looking. And as a priority, we plan to improve, and we're committed to improving safety. We plan to work closer with neighborhoods, residents, and organizations so that together we can bring about more and more neighborhood improvements.
Yeah. You've probably seen the fine work of the city's new graffiti abatement program. Last year, a new graffiti truck and staff hit the streets to paint over graffiti. As you walked in this morning, you may have noticed the truck outside, or you can notice it on your way out. After the last year, almost 3,000 graffiti calls in the last year, we've seen faster response times to paint out graffiti and better working relationship with the merchants. The city-funded Looking Good Santa Barbara program has provided us with a few neighborhood cleanup kits, so let's go ahead and raffle them off. Roger Horton will draw the next ticket. Those little yellow tickets, there you go. There you go, Roger.
And the winner is 462427.
2427. Just raise your hand, and somebody will give you that graffiti abatement kit. It's very cool. Then you can do the work that we're supposed to be doing. No, I'm kidding. And the next, Helene Schneider. One more, and then Grant House. We got it.
Good morning. As a resident of the West Side, I can attest that the graffiti truck and the shopping carts really do work well. Along with your kit, you should put in your cell phone the graffiti hotline. The number is 897-2513. So call, when I walk around and call it up, and the next day it's gone. The winner is 462-180.
There's one back there.
Here we go.
One back there. Is that Mrs. Sweeney?
It is.
And Grant House.
Great. Well, they say the best deterrent is to get it down as quickly as possible. And if you keep one of these in your sewing machine delivery van, you can... is that good? Okay. Anyway, the number, the winning number is 462-266.
266. There, no?
Huh?
Well, we'll go on. We'll go on. boy, that was a little plug there, Grant. He snuck it in there. Now I'd like to talk about some of our long-range planning projects that will improve neighborhoods, roads, and community infrastructure. As you may know, the final phase of the State Street Beautification Project has begun and will be completed in early May. New brick sidewalks, landscaping, and street furnishing improvements are being completed on State Street from Cota to Gutierrez Streets. Yes, some trees were removed as part of the project, but more trees will be planted in the end. I won't repeat that. Yes, more trees will be planted. All businesses are open during construction work. The Granada Garage was completed last year. It's performing very well. The garage is currently serving more customers than the former surface parking lot did. Yeah, finally. It's really a nice little garage. It's anticipated the garage will continue to draw more customers from other busy downtown lots in the future, especially when the renovation of the Granada Theater is completed. The project received 5 awards last year, including the Public Works Association Project of the Year. One of the best ways to get downtown is to hop on the MTD bus. In March, the city and MTD increased the frequency of bus service for local residents. This project increased the headways of the busiest bus lines in the city during peak commute times from 15 minutes to every 10 minutes. A new route has also been added, the Mesa Loop, which runs between downtown and the Mesa. This enhanced service provides extra added convenience and encourages people to use alternative transportation. After more than 3 years of construction and years of planning before that, the Sheffield Water Quality Project is complete. An old reservoir was replaced with 2 underground concrete reservoirs, and on top of the reservoirs, over 150 trees and 35,000 native plants have been planted. More than a mile of pedestrian trails have been added. This new open space is maintained by our Parks and Recreation Department. Another high-profile Parks and Recreation project is the 1235 Teen Center, opened a few weeks ago.
Chapala is the home of our new Teen Center. It's the result of over 2 years of work by teens in this community, and this is truly community at its best. This project came about because teens were talking about the need for a place for them to be, to spend time, to do fun things, to get them off the streets. They fought for this idea, they fought for the building, and with City Council's concurrence, we began the process of designing this building to meet the needs of the teens. Teens have been involved from day one. It's really been their project. One of the first things that we learned as we were meeting with teens and talking with them about what they wanted this place to be is they did not want it over-programmed. They really wanted a place where they could come and hang out with their friends and be safe, be engaged with each other in positive activities. What they created were spaces where you can just come and hang out with your friends, you can play games. There are also spaces for studying, computer access, and just really places where you can come and do as much or as little as you want. You can just be here and hang out with your friends. You will also be able to take classes and participate in programs and activities that are designed for and by teens. Truly, this is a project which came from the community we serve that said, you need to do something for us because our needs are great. Government responded, the city council responded by saying, we agree, how do we make this happen? And then by working together and finding the funding, we made it happen and the doors are open. It's just great.
As you know, we've hired Irene Macias as the new library director. One of her first major projects is establishing an endowment to support the operational needs of the library and future building improvements. This will help provide stability for a great community resource in the lean budget years. Moving on to our airport, we're building a new terminal building, including the refurbishment of the historic 1942, that's right. It predates me even, the historic 1942 terminal. The project will improve the adjacent roadway, public parking, and aircraft ramps. The terminal expansion is expected to meet current and federal and future airline passenger needs. Project will begin the design phase in March. Actually, it did begin. Another airport project is the Airfield Safety Project. This $35 million project includes constructing 1,000-foot safety areas in each end of the main runway and over $9 million in wetlands restoration to the Goleta Slough. Through this project, the airport will meet current FAA standards for federal runway safety areas and improve safety for the flying public. The safety areas will be constructed next summer. One of our city's challenges is helping the chronically homeless population that rotates between the streets, county jails, the emergency room, costing the city and county millions of dollars each year. We are taking a leadership role in this matter. The El Carrillo project was completed this last year, providing 61 units of single-room occupancy housing to help people transition out of homelessness. The city worked with the county and other agencies to develop a 10-year plan to end chronic homelessness. This plan will send trained social workers to go out on the streets and connect people with drug rehab treatments, mental health services, and basic housing. Many of you have heard of or have been involved in ongoing conversation about the Upper State Street area. With the number of large projects under construction there, the city is working to identify short-term urban design and circulation improvements along that corridor. The draft study was released a couple of weeks ago for public review and will be considered by the City Council in May. Now that the Upper State Street study is in its final stages, our planning division is ready to relaunch the Plan Santa Barbara effort, which will update our city's general plan.
Plan Santa Barbara is our general plan update. It's the opportunity we take as a city and a community every 20 years or so to talk about our future, and primarily around growth-related type issues, but even more than that. But where do we want to go with our housing, our transportation, our land use decisions as a community? And so it's a chance to come together and comprehensively talk about our vision for the next 20, 30, 40 years. Public outreach is so important to updating a city's general plan, and it's something that Santa Barbara has a proud tradition of doing a lot of, and we intend to do it again here. We hope to have informational forums where we bring in guest speakers, have community forums and discussions, but we also want to get out to the smaller groups. And so the staff is ready and willing anytime anyone is interested to go and meet with your group, your boards, or whatever affiliations you might be with that might be interested in Plan Santa Barbara. We'll come talk to you in the comforts of your own conference room and have a great discussion and get your input as part of that. But it really needs to be the community coming together and having a common vision and goal about where we want to go. And that's what we want to try to accomplish to facilitate that and get all that information to the City Council so they can make the best decision possible. It's really important that the business community be involved, because I think all different interest groups need to be part of this discussion. And one important thing that's going to be discussed is Measure E. That is a charter amendment adopted in 1989 that restricted our amount of new commercial square footage that could be approved. And it expires in a couple years. And so one of the discussions we're going to have is where do we go as a community with regards to new commercial development? And tied into that, how do we make sure and maintain a strong, vibrant economy locally? And what are the decisions that the city can make that influences that and make sure we make smart decisions?
Now I'd like to introduce our city administrator, Jim Armstrong, who will give you an outlook on the city's financial condition. Jim?
Thank you, Mayor Bloom. I am pleased once again to provide you with a brief overview of the management and fiscal issues facing our city. As I've indicated to you in the past, it's important to understand that our city is a major business enterprise employing over 1,000 full-time employees, 500 part-time employees, and with an operating budget over $200 million. We provide services to residents and businesses not only in Santa Barbara but over the entire South Coast. And we have 11 operating departments and 140 different program service areas. One of the major issues facing all of California is the way in which we finance government services. In city government, we depend on a variety of tax revenues, from sales taxes, property taxes, utility taxes, bed taxes, to finance the traditional governmental services like police, fire, parks and recreation, libraries, and planning and community development. These revenues are susceptible to regional changes in the economy and, of course, changes to state law. The city also operates several enterprise operations which are fully funded from fees, charges, and lease revenues. They receive no tax support. Examples of our enterprise operations are the airport, our water utility, our wastewater utility, our downtown parking operation, our golf enterprise, and also the waterfront and harbor. I'm happy to report that the city continues to be in excellent financial condition. The general fund of the city, which finances those traditional governmental services, had a small surplus in fiscal year 2006, and we predict we'll have another surplus again for the year that ends on June 30th. As we're putting together our budget for next fiscal year, we are carefully watching both the local economy and the state's budget situation. At the local level, we have seen a definite slowdown in the local economy. Our bed tax growth has slowed down significantly from the last 2 years, and our retail sales have been virtually flat over the last few quarters. We have also seen a moderate decline in building activity from the very high levels that we saw the last few years. At the state level, we continue to be concerned about the state's overall financial condition and its ongoing structural deficit. Tax collections for the state over the first 2 months in calendar year 2007 have been about $2 billion below what the state predicted. And we are going to be watching closely as that when the governor presents what they call the May revise in May to see how the state's going to deal with their ongoing financial difficulties. The state has major financial challenges ahead, and the recent infrastructure bonds that were approved by the voters in November, all the good news for those of us that are concerned about infrastructure, are going to put additional strains on the state's general fund. We're finalizing our budget for presentation to the City Council in about 2 weeks, and we'll be proposing a very tight year, or tight two-year financial plan that will continue to replenish reserves and with some additional money for capital infrastructure. However, due to the very uncertain economy, it's going to be a very tight budget plan for the next couple of years. Speaking of reserves, our city continues to maintain healthy reserves in our general fund. We expect to end the year with about $24 million of cash reserves in the general fund, which is about 25% of our operating budget. Although this is slightly under our policy reserves, it's very healthy for a city the size of Santa Barbara. In addition, our enterprise operations also have cash reserves should a major emergency strike. Generally, these reserves are also about 25% of our operating expenditures. And to put it in perspective, here are some examples of the reserves we have in our enterprise operations. In the water fund, we have a little over $12 million. In the wastewater fund, over $6 million. The airport, $7 million. Downtown parking, $4.2 million. And at the waterfront and harbor, $5.7 million. With our aging infrastructure and Santa Barbara's history of natural disasters such as floods, fires, and earthquakes, it's critical that we continue to have adequate cash reserves if a major emergency strikes. Although I think the city is in excellent financial condition, I do want to discuss a few of the challenges that we're going to be dealing with in the years ahead. First, I'd like to talk about the issue that all of us in this room face, and that's the cost of retaining and attracting qualified employees. Recently, this problem was most significant in our inability to attract and retain qualified police officers. This is not just a Santa Barbara phenomenon. This is a national problem faced by police departments throughout the country. It's caused by a number of factors, including that less young people are interested in law enforcement careers. We've also had a large number of individuals, not only in our police department, but nationally retire, and there's continued low unemployment nationally. As a result, in 2005 and 2006, we saw a number of our qualified officers hired by other police agencies, especially down in Ventura County, to be closer to their homes, and these agencies were paying comparable salaries. As you know, we had very difficult negotiations with our police union, but we are able finally to reach a 3.5-year agreement that will increase compensation to the police officers by about 28%. The cost of these increases will clearly be a challenge in the next 3 years and will impact our ability to improve services in other areas. But our challenge in attracting and retaining qualified employees doesn't just go with police officers. We face the same difficulties that you face in attracting engineers, planners, recreation specialists, librarians, clerical support, and top management employees. As an organization, we will not only have to pay competitive wages and quality benefits, but also be an organization that provides ongoing educational and career development activities. Meeting the challenge of keeping wages and benefits competitive will continue to strain the budget over the next few years and leave little room for program enhancements. The second challenge I want to discuss with you today is the need to invest in the city's capital infrastructure. The city's capital plant is huge. We have over 268 miles of roads, 200 miles of sewer and water lines, 1,750 acres of parks and open space, and over 100 separate buildings and facilities, everything from marinas, wharfs, our airport, our wastewater treatment plant, our water treatment plant, Gibraltar Dam, parking structures, and the list goes on and on. The replacement value of these facilities is somewhere in the range of $2 billion, and it's critical to our long-term health and the city's economic vitality that we maintain this infrastructure. We recently completed a comprehensive six-year capital improvement plan and presented it to the City Council in two workshops, and we identified over $440 million of projects that need to be done in the next 6 years. Unfortunately, over $145 million of those projects are unfunded. Among the projects in this category is a new police headquarters to replace the aging facility that we have on Figueroa Street, sufficient funds to upgrade our fire headquarters on Carrillo and make it seismically safe, and major improvements to our parks and recreation facilities. Additionally, we are underfunded by about $48 million in transportation and street facilities. As you know, this has been a major area of emphasis for the state with the recent approval of several bond issues, but clearly more needs to be done. In the very near future, I expect that the mayor and council will be asking citizens and business leaders to help them in tackling this issue. It will not be easy, but we have a responsibility to the future of this community to maintain the extensive public investment that we already have. The last challenge I want to discuss with you is the need to work together with the rest of the county to ensure the renewal of the current half-cent sales tax, Measure D, for transportation. This tax has been in place since 1990 and has been a critical component in our ability to maintain our transportation infrastructure and also to provide support to MTD. When the tax was originally approved in the late 1980s, it required a majority vote, simple 50% plus one. But now with new state law, it will require a two-thirds vote to renew it. I think most of you know in November there was a three-quarter cent sales tax that was proposed to the voters. And although it received nearly a two-thirds vote here in Santa Barbara, it did not receive even a majority vote in North County. Our city currently spends $5.2 million of Measure D funds every year to maintain our street network, to provide basic maintenance and pothole repair, and also to assist MTD in enhanced bus service and reducing congestion. Additionally, the Santa Barbara County Association of Governments has identified $3 billion of transportation improvements that need to be done over the next 30 years. Even if the half-cent sales tax is approved, it'll only generate about $1 billion of that $3 billion need. But it'll be a critical provide critical matching funds for state and federal funds so we can go forward with extensive transportation improvements. We're all aware of the need to improve the transportation system on the South Coast in Santa Barbara County, and I encourage all of you to work on ensuring that Measure D is renewed when it gets back on the ballot. Before I turn the podium back to Mayor Bloom, I do also want to add my appreciation to the department heads who have the best seat in the house over here, who have been recognized today, but also to the many fantastic employees we have working for the city. The citizens of this community are fortunate to have a group of energetic, intelligent, and dedicated employees in our workforce, and I'm amazed every day by the quality of the people we have working for us. They're constantly pushing the envelope, and they're ensuring that our city is a leader in innovation and creativity. It's my great pleasure to manage them on a day-to-day basis. Now I'll turn it back over to the mayor.
Thanks, Jim. We're fortunate to have Jim work for us, too. Our city has developed, this is the last of the four major areas, and it's sustainability. Our city has developed many successful programs to help us become leaders in environmental sustainability. We are recycling far more than we throw away. We're pioneering new methods to clean our creeks and ocean water, and we're increasing energy efficiency and the use of renewable energy. Our community has come a long way in environmental practices. Let's take a look at some of our meetings with community leaders before we understood sustainability. Remember, this is just a dramatization. Mm-hmm. Remember, that was the before shot. Later, I'm going to show you a clip from a more recent meeting. Our environmental problems have never been more urgent. Scientists around the world are calling our attention to climate change. Our continued reliance on conventional transportation, power plants, and our feeding global warming. Burning fossil fuels such as coal, oil, and gas to run cars, buildings, and power plants is leading to a rise in greenhouse gases. These gases have contributed to an increase in the average temperature on Earth, in the Earth's atmosphere, and in the oceans, known as global warming. I am very proud to say that this city is putting its own house in order first when it comes to being sustainable. We've created a new Sustainable Santa Barbara program that helps us share the good work of our environmental programs with the community. As part of a global effort, we're taking action now by using smarter energy technologies that increase efficiency and rely on clean, renewable energy resources. Starting with the base year of 2005, we are now tracking our greenhouse gas emissions from our city facilities and vehicles and learning how to reduce them. We're pioneers in the renewable energy arena. The El Estero wastewater treatment plant built the first commercial fuel cell in Santa Barbara, in California, supplying almost half of the plant's demand for electricity. This innovative technology converts methane gas into enough energy to power 500 homes. The project recently won a grand prize award from the League of California Cities. This year, we're building a few other renewable energy projects. We're installing solar panels on Fire Station 2 on Cacique Street, and we're including solar panels in the new fire department administrative building on Carrillo and Chapala Streets. We're also looking into reactivation of a hydroelectric plant to power the Cater Water Treatment Plant, estimated at meeting over one half of the plant's energy needs. I am proud to say that we're participating in the federal Million Solar Roofs program, which has a goal of installing solar panels on 1 million U.S. roofs by 2010. In December, the City Council adopted solar design guidelines for private development projects. We will publicly recognize solar energy projects consistent with these guidelines at a council hearing in June. One of our most cost-efficient ways to reduce global warming emissions is to conserve energy. Turning off the lights, computers, and equipment is the cheapest way for us to curb emissions. That's exactly what we're doing with our city buildings. Well, everyone, you're in for a treat. I'd like to introduce you to Captain Electric. See, he is showing off some lights, but not just any lights. Those are LEDs, or light-emitting diodes, in the form of holiday lighting. They're about 90% more efficient than traditional incandescent bulbs. Not only will they save energy and lower your utility bills, these lights are very durable and safe. They're made of hard plastic instead of glass and produce no heat at all. Our fire department loves them. We decorated City Hall Holiday Tree with these lights last year, and they've helped keep our energy bills low. Also, our traffic signals were all converted to LEDs a few years ago, resulting in a tremendous energy savings. Thank you, Captain Electric. You don't have to wear them, just to let you know. We've recently approved a green building policy for city facilities. This new policy will ensure that all new construction and upgrades to city buildings meet high standards for energy efficiency. We're also working with local architects on new green building standards for private development projects. Some of our recent green building projects include the 914 State Street restrooms and the Granada Garage. These projects included natural daylight design, low water using facilities, and recycled content building materials. As part of our sustainability effort, the city is also using alternative fuels in its fleet. Starting last July, the city began using B20 biodiesel in over 100 city vehicles. B20 is a blend of 80% diesel fuel and 20% soybean oil. It reduces exhaust emissions and supports clean air. By making the switch, the city became one of the first cities in the nation to use biodiesel as a principal fuel. Biodiesel is used in our fire engines and in the city emergency generators. In addition to biodiesel, the city's vehicles use a variety of alternative fuels, including compressed natural gas, electric, and hybrid technology. In the area of alternative transportation, the city is encouraging employees to use carpools, vanpools, walking, bicycles, or transit for their work commute. We have a bicycle fleet that employees can use to run errands during the day. We have now started a weekly drawing for a gift card at local businesses, and we're also developing a rideshare policy where employees can borrow a city vehicle for personal errands and appointments during the workday. One innovative way we can save vehicle trips for our employees is moving toward a new 980 employee work schedule. It involves 80 hours of work over 9 days instead of the traditional 10-day schedule. We'll kick this off in July. Public counters will be open for longer hours each day and will close on alternating Fridays. This project is expected to reduce vehicle trips and air pollution, improve employee retention, and give the public more flexible hours at our offices. Another sustainability effort is our integrated pest management program. 98% of the city parkland is maintained green. This means we use the least toxic materials and methods to maintain the parks. 39 of the city's 49 parks are managed with 100% pesticide free. Overall, our community is now diverting 63% of the trash from the Tahiquas landfill. Preventing waste through reducing recycling and reusing is a top priority for the city. The city organization has implemented a zero waste program It is now the standard procedure for events where food is served. Instead of using plastic cups, forks, and plates, we're producing compostable utensils made of cornstarch and sugar cane. Along with leftover food scraps, everything is diverted from the landfill and going instead to a commercial composting operation. In the end, the compost is returned to the land as soil amendment. We're working hard to bring this program to large community events, opening up the opportunity to compost thousands of pounds of material every month. We're also helping the school district become great recyclers. The city has provided recycling containers and education for the schools. In the end, all of this has helped the school save thousands of dollars each month. The city is a leader in water conservation. We provide monthly water use reports for property owners with dedicated irrigation meters. And we compare their usage to a weather-based water calculator. The goal is to educate these high water use customers, identifying ways to help them irrigate more efficiently. A commercial rebate program is also coming soon. This program will offer rebates for the installation of water efficient fixtures and appliances for local businesses. There are numerous water quality and habitat restoration projects underway. The restoration of Mesa Creek and Aurora Borough Estuary was completed in January. A significant feature of this water quality project was the daylighting of Mesa Creek. Once confined to a concrete culvert, it now flows above the ground to the estuary, representing the first of its kind on the south coast, and you can see it at Cliff Drive and Las Positas Corner. Clean water efforts at our harbor have earned it a California Clean Marina certification, one of only four public marinas to earn this distinction. This certification demonstrates the commitment to a healthy ocean and our leadership role in the production of protection of natural resources. Well, here it is. Earlier I showed you our first sustainability meeting with community leaders. Now let's take a look at the latest meeting.
A glow shoots up through the stony ground. There's no room, no space to rent in this town. You're out of luck, and the reason that you had to care, the traffic is stuck, and you're not moving. Take you out of this place, someone you can lend a hand in return for grace. It's a beautiful. Yeah.
Well, now you know how you can be sustainable. You don't have to do the worm thing if you don't want to, though. I hope you will enjoy us being, and I hope you will join us in being a leader in sustainability. At your places, you find a tote bag made of 100% recycled cotton that you can use to carry your grocery items instead of that paper or plastic bags from the store. We just noted that San Francisco banned plastic bags. We've included some items in the bag to help you take sustainable steps at home. There's a tire pressure gauge that keeps the right tire pressure and saves on gasoline. A CFL bulb you can take home to replace an incandescent bulb. A reusable mug you can avoid throwing away hundreds of coffee cups every year. A dye tab for you to test your plumbing for water leaks. And compostable utensils to make your next meal a zero waste event. We've also provided you a copy, there must be copies on the tables, of our annual report to learn more about our sustainability program. And with these items, you too can be green. In the key areas of public safety, neighborhood improvement, long-range planning, and sustainability, we've met many goals as well as faced some challenges. A dynamic combination between the City Council and the community's involvement has helped us come up with some creative solutions. We hope you will continue to participate in our city, keep it a vibrant and a great place to live, work, and play. I'm looking forward to working with all of you in this coming year to face our challenges and fulfill our goals. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to be here, and most of all, thank you for helping this wonderful city lead by example. Thank you.